which is the most common respiratory disorder which we come across in our day-to-day routine in anesthesia. So it is a disease which causes progressive loss of alveolar tissue and airflow obstruction, which affects both central and peripheral airways, lung parenchymal and pulmonary vasculature. It is a non-reversible narrowing of airways, remodeling of airway smooth muscle, increased numbers of goblet cells and mucus secreting glands, and pulmonary vasculature changes resulting in pulmonary hypertension. It includes asthma, bronchitis and emphysema. Now, what is the etiology? Most commonly, it is a smoking, and then there is occupational exposure, then recurrent respiratory tract infections in childhood, and alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. What are the symptoms? Chronic cough and sputum production, dyspnea on exertion, prolonged expiratory time, and decreased breath sounds and wheezes. What are we looking for in these patients when we do a anesthesia checkup is, we have to obtain a detailed history like the course and severity of the disease, the frequency of exacerbations, medications used, and exercise tolerance. And what do we do? What do we advise to these patients? We advise them cessation of smoking first of all, and if it is an elective surgery, it is better to provide them a cessation of smoking period of around 4 to 6 weeks, which improves mucociliary function and it decreases the level of carboxyhemoglobin. Now we have to treat the evidence of expiratory flow obstruction. We have to use bronchodilators, pre-op nebulization and lung volume expansion with incentive spirometry, and we have to also assess the patient for associated features of core pulmonale, which is present in the patients with prolonged COPD. The next are the simple bedside tests we do to assess the cardiopulmonary reserve of the patient, which is cough test, in which the patient is asked to cough, and if it leads to recurrent coughing, it indicates underlying bronchitis. Then there is wheeze test, in which we ask the patient to take 5 deep inspirations and then we auscultate the patients for presence of wheezing. Then another one is the indicator of airway obstruction, which is maximum laryngeal height, and it is measured from the top of the thyroid cartilage to the suprasternal notch at the end of inspiration. And if it is less than 4 cm, it is abnormal, it indicates airway obstruction. Another one, very simple test, very routinely performed, is the breath holding test, and it is the patient is asked to take a deep inspiration and hold it as much as he can. And if it is more than 25 seconds, it is a normal cardiopulmonary reserve. If it is 15 to 25 seconds, it is borderline. And if it is less than 15 seconds, it is severe cardiopulmonary reserve deficiency. Next is the match blowing test, generally not performed, but important from the point of view of examination. It is done by asking the patient to blow a matchstick at a distance of 15 centimeter, and if the patient is able to blow it, it indicates maximum breathing capacity of more than 60 liter per minute. Then another one is de Bono whistle blowing test, which measures the peak expiratory flow rate of the patient. And another is forced expiratory time or tracheal auscultation. If the breath sounds are audible for more than 6 seconds, it denotes significant airway obstruction. Now, what else do we need to assess the cardiopulmonary reserve is the right ventricular function. In cases with patients having COPD for a longer period of time, we do advise 2D echo to know the status of right ventricle. And this is the typical chest X-ray of a patient with COPD showing increased rib spaces, dilated bronchovascular markings. Now what do we do for treatment? Same, cessation of smoking for as long as possible. Now then there is a long-term oxygen therapy if the patient is having PaO2 of less than 55%. So it decreases arterial hypoxemia, and there is no better therapy for decreasing the pulmonary vascular resistance than giving supplemental oxygen. Drug therapies include salmeterol, formoterol, and inhaled corticosteroids. Now what do we do in intraoperative management? We try to provide regional anesthesia as much as possible. But if in case we have to give general anesthesia, these are the points we should take in mind. Pre-oxygenation is very important in these patients, and we should take measures to decrease the air trapping. How do we do that? By increasing the expiratory time by increasing I ratio. Now we have to also allow permissive hypercapnia, because these patients have a CO2 level which is more than the normal population. Now applying low level of extrinsic PEEP just as to match their auto PEEP, and aggressively treating any bronchospasm if present. As much as possible, we should avoid intubation. We should use non-invasive masks like laryngeal masks. And induction agents of choice would be propofol, ketamine, and maintenance should be done with volatile anesthetics because they are excellent bronchodilators, except desflurane. Other adjuvants should be used to decrease any reflexes during intubation, such as lidocaine, and we should also use of laryngotracheal lidocaine is a mixed opinion about that. Some use it, some might say that it increases airway resistance. Now what do we face during intraoperative management of these patients is they have generally auto PEEP, so how can it be reduced? We should use continuous positive airway pressure during induction. It increases the efficacy of pre-oxygenation. Any hemodynamic compromises can occur during general anesthesia due to fall in preload, which is secondary to increase in intrathoracic pressure. So that should be considered in mind before inducing these patients. Ventilation should be aimed at reducing the dynamic hyperinflation, intrinsic PEEP, and air trapping. The harmful effects of these include hypertension, barotrauma, and trauma to the lungs, volume trauma, hypercapnia, and acidosis. The measures which we take to reduce air trapping includes using smaller tidal volumes and lower respiratory rates with more time for expiration. Shortening the inspiratory time increases the peak inspiratory flow, thereby facilitating a better ventilation of all the alveoli. We can use non-invasive ventilation after extubation and as well as before extubation, before induction, to decrease the respiratory limitations combined with regional techniques, which would serve as an alternative when tracheal intubation is to be avoided. Now, fluid administration should be restricted to decrease pulmonary edema. It has been accepted in thoracic surgery and showed good outcomes. Now, what is autopositive end expiratory pressure? It is an auto PEEP which is already present in these patients, and it becomes even more important during mechanical ventilation. It is directly proportional to the tidal volume and inversely proportional to expiratory time. So as I said earlier, to decrease auto PEEP, measures we use are using lesser tidal volume, increasing expiratory time. What is it has been found to develop in most patients during one lung ventilation. So what we do is we can add an amount of PEEP which is equal to auto PEEP. Then is hemodynamic instability in chronic obstructive patients. It is because of the hyperinflated lungs, the elevation of intrathoracic pressure results in decreased systemic venous return, and it may be transmitted to pulmonary artery, raising pulmonary vascular resistance and leading to right heart strain. So movement of interventricular septum into left ventricle impairs its filling. This explains the cardiovascular instability in these patients. Then another complication which we face in these patients is atelectasis, and it is because of the intrinsic PEEP, loss of elastic recoil of lungs, and increased stiffness of chest wall. So, and there is also a relaxation of abdominal muscular tone after anesthesia, which promotes caudal displacement of diaphragm. So they exhibit already a weaker hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction and blunted ventilatory responses to CO2 and hypoxia. So these are the problems we face, and the measure to solve these problems is to increase the expiratory time, prevent bronchospasm, and during extubation we must take care that patient is not hypoxic, patient is warm, well oxygenated, close to normal preoperative value, and absence of secretions and a hypercapnic state, and absence of respiratory depression. Peri-extubation bronchodilator treatment may be helpful Extubation of high-risk patient directly to non-invasive ventilation may reduce the work of breathing and air trapping and has been shown to reduce the need for reintubation in post-operative period after major surgery. Thank you.